Thank you, Adam Armour and Professor Eduardo Croci and the B.BIAS Bocconi Behavioral Insights Association of Students to invite to this exciting event. So I want to talk today a bit about how to tackle climate change with behavioral economics. And I want to present larger parts of about 10 years of research on behavioral economics in the environmental domain. Well, it started from a project on global responsible intergenerational leadership was this notion that intergenerational conscientiousness is human imbued and natural behavioral law. But then I also wanted to see how globalization puts emergent risks onto unborn future generations. And what I did is in my first project, collect social representations of intergenerational equity. Social representations, this theory is actually a theory that comes from Europe, from Professor Anna Maria Silvana De Rosa in Rome, and she looks into how external information gets transferred into society. And what I did is I went to a future conference in 2011 on justice responsibility for the future. I had the videotapes of the conference on presenters, and I had from 110 experts from all different stakeholder groups, a bit less than 50,000 words that I could then categorize into content associations. And what I find is in 2011, intergenerational equity is perceived in the need for a pension reform. Leaders in Europe were concerned about the aging Western world population. I see problems of over indebtedness when children are born with already a heavy debt rucksack in some countries, and ecological sustainability arising on the horizon. Future leaders think about climate change. From the social representations, you can also see the categorization contents in relation to the different stakeholder groups. I calculated here a correspondence chart in which I find that in 2011, religious leaders thought about the legal foundations of intergenerational equity. International organizations thought about energy efficiency. Finance and economics was still concerned about over-indebtedness after the 2008-09 world financial recession. Politics thought about common goods allocation norms, and media was questioning what is intergenerational equity, and academia was kind of cynical, saying we cannot change anything at all. But we do have these behavioral solutions that you can either apply on the top-down institution level, or more see how you can change bottom up democracy in action on environmental concerns. Back to the point on conscientiousness for future generations, I also conducted mental temporal accounting studies, which are finding behavioral economics nudges within human beings to care about the environment. My two books on behavioral economics and finance leadership and Verhaltensökonomie und Verhaltensfinanzökonomie, which is the European version of this book, I started conducting behavioral experiments. And I started from David Leibson's hyperbolic discounting thought that people care about the now way more than about the future, and Richard Thaler's theory about mental accounting, that you have these buckets or these compartments for financial allocations. And I wanted to see if this also holds in time dimensions. And I was interested in social, economic, and environmental timeframes, how they change human behavior in the environment. Over 4 different studies and 565 subjects, I find 2 interesting behavioral thoughts. On the one hand, I see when you put people into an environmental condition and people think about the environment, they perceive that they have more time and they spend their time more conscientiously. And this also holds with parents. So once you have this critical life event that you become a father or a mother, you start perceiving that you have more time and you spend your time more conscientiously. You make more use of your time. And those are 2 beautiful behavioral effects that I find over 565 human subjects that an environmental frame and being parents makes you think at the end of your days that you really used your time preciously. In another project on ecologic sustainability, I was concerned how you can bottom up change people's perception of the environment and their pro-social behavior when it comes to recycling and environmental ethicality. So what I did is when I was at Harvard, I did 2 field observations. One was in summer school dormitories. So in these dormitories over the summer, students come in and they want to most of the time then apply to become full-time graduate students at Harvard. And what I did is I had these 3 test conditions in the dormitories in which I exposed them to social status insignias. I showed them the logo of Harvard University and the sustainability all at Harvard in order to peg social status to social norms of being conscientious when it comes to the environment. And then I had a neutral condition. And then what I wanted to show in these field experiments was when you take away social status, that people actually become more socially conscientious and comply more to social norms. Here in the dependent variable, I measured how people would comply with recycling instructions. In this field experiment, 3 test conditions, here you see it better. In the recycling area, I had a Harvard and sustainability at Harvard logos as social status insignia and social norm representations. And when I take it away, when people were first exposed for a few weeks to them, and then when it was taken away, that actually significantly increased their recycling compliance. In a second field study, I also looked into the university and sustainability at university insignia being placed in reading carrels at university libraries and clear instructions to please switch off lights after use. So in these reading carrels, people could control the light themselves and often they would be left on and would run overnight or during a sunny day the whole day. And in these 3 test conditions, I once again first exposed students to these social status insignia and instructions to comply to social norms to switch off light after use. And again, I find once you remove the social status insignia. So once you take away social status from people, they become more socially conscientious and comply to social norms to become more environmentally ethical. In the next phase of the study, I also wanted to see if you can use intergenerational equity behavioral nudges. So what I was doing was I wanted to see if you can curb harmful myopic decision-making that the now is more important in the public policy domain. What I wanted to show is when you bundle 2 policies, one that is more focused on the now and one that is more future-oriented, when you bundle them and put them next to each other, people would become more intergenerationally conscientious. So this temporal bundling strategy was also used in the international context. I also wanted to see if this is a human imbued cue by showing these bundles all over the world. In order to operationalize intergenerational equity, I used public policies and I created out of the UN that holds a report on all public policies, 64 public policies that are resembling public policies that are practiced around the world. And I had them rated by 120 experts and students on the time of the policy impact in order to measure the future-orientedness and the choice of people on the dimension of future orientation. And the second rating dimension was social responsibility. How much does this contribute to social responsible behavior? I ran the studies on Amazon Mechanical Turk in an online version, but also in a paper and pen version in mainland China. And the dependent variable was how much fictitious tax units people would allocate towards these different public policy choices. As you can see here, those are the public policies that were bundles of policies that are more now focused and more future oriented or more socially responsible and less socially responsible. And the five different categories over which they span were culture, economics, education, foreign aid, and infrastructure, and the environment. So what I manipulated in my online experiments, but also in the paper and pen version, was to show policies either as ones, singles, combined here together, or bundled, really put together. And I ran the study also with 223 Chinese students at a university, European University's China campus. What you see here in the results is that the bundled strategy, the more I put different policies together in the combined and in the bundled version, the more intergenerationally harmonious the choice becomes, which is represented here with the zero. So we become more intergenerationally conscientious if public policies are presented as bundles. Interestingly, I also find that social responsibility depletes when you put bundles of choices together. And this might be explained when you bundle. This bundling strategy makes people more rational and potentially also less socially responsible. I also find the same pattern in China. So this seems to be a human imbued cue. The more you bundle, the less or the more intergenerationally equitable people become, but the less socially responsible. Overall, this leads to the assumption that we should have a multi-step decision-making in which you evaluate policies separately, then jointly, and then separately again, or you should have age-differentiated consortia, so put elder and younger together when making choices over public policy. In another experiment, I wanted to see if trust and reciprocity can help in driving social common goods allocation norms. This is in the realm of tax psychology, and I wanted to see if you can use psychological triggers of trust and reciprocity in order to get people to be more contributing to social norms and contributions. So what I also wanted to see is how this plays out on the two dimensions of intergenerational equity, future conscientiousness, and social responsibility. How I operationalized this was at the Harvard University Decision Science Laboratory, where I ran 256 participants who played first an economic trust game and then a common goods game. In the socio-economic trust game, player one can allocate funds to player two can drive reciprocity by playing back. In the common goods game, the players decide how much they allocate to a common goods pool, and then the pool gets divided by all players together. I also had these bundles of public policy choices again. The time of the policy impact varied, and the socially responsible conscientiousness of the policy varied. What I find over 256 players in a behavioral economics lab is in 128 player ones, if they play and trust and allocate a lot to player two, this is significantly positively correlated with overall common goods contribution norms. And if player two plays back, this is significantly positively correlated with social goods contribution. So trust and reciprocity are powerful nudges to get people to contribute to social common goods allocation norms. And common goods allocation is also positively correlated with future-oriented public policy choices, and reciprocity is positively associated with socially responsible choices. Overall, trust and reciprocity do drive common goods allocation norms. And now I want to shift it more to macroeconomic insights. I also created this intergenerational equity leadership macroeconomic model in order to help UN Law Commission intergenerational transfers, or in particularly the UN climate change negotiations that center around how to transfer benefits, but also to share the burden over generations equitable in the climate stabilization domain. In this first macroeconomic intergenerational transfer model, I wanted to see that public and private sector benefits and transfers and burden sharing over different generations in the domains of social, environmental, and economic factors. Macroeconomically, I used macroeconomic data in public social responsibility by using the World Bank Social Capital Index. In the private sector, I used a social responsibility reporting of KPMG. Future-orientedness was operationalized in the public sector by governmental educational investment spending, and in the private sector by the global leadership and organizational behavior effectiveness. And the dependent variable were how much a country would transfer into next generations, not only the benefits, but also the burdens in the public and private sector domains in environmental, economic, and social dimensions. What I find over 194 world countries is, in a cross-sectional regression, that future-oriented parts of the world feature more environmental recycling and waste management conscientious. They think more about if the youth is employed, and there's more of an inter-family wealth transfer. But the caveat, what I find over 194 wealth countries, is also that deficit spending countries lack social capital. Lastly, I want to introduce my really macroeconomic model on mapping climate justice, and this is in the realm of macroeconomics. I map climate justice on three dimensions. First, I'm concerned that within a society, there's fairness that not some parts of marginalized groups carry a heavier burden of the climate change mitigation and adaptation agenda. Fairness between countries speaks about what country differences we have and if there's a disparate impact on the world of global warming. And fairness between countries is thinking about that one generation is not using up or abusing the climate and leaves the climate in a worse state to future generations. Macroeconomically, between country differences, I have this model in which I put in different mean temperatures around the globe, GDP composition, so gross domestic productivity measured on agriculture, service and industry sectors, and a different peak temperature condition per industry over the entire world. And we live in a changing climate, and with these factors, the mean temperature, the GDP composition per country, the different peak temperature per GDP level, we can say that the greener the country in the world map here, the more the country has time ahead until they reach peak condition. I can already now say that only a few countries in the world will gain a lot from global warming in the short run. And over a data set of 181 countries in the world, I see a positive, significant correlation between being a climate change winner and greenhouse gas emissions. So those countries that are emitting are also gaining from climate change on the short run. I see already climate-induced migration into the winning temperatures, zones, and financial inflows into the countries that have a rising GDP growth. Overall, I only highlight these differences, the disparate impact of climate, changing climate around the world, in order to show ways how to redistribute some of the gains into the losing areas. So this is the last part of my presentation. I want to show these redistribution mechanisms, and I show a few potential factors that you can integrate into a model how to redistribute gains of a climate change into the losing areas. GDP per inhabitant factored into gaining world countries leads to the greener countries here should be distributing to the red countries of the world. Five indexes were calculated. In the first one, I measure being a climate change winner or loser, and CO2 emissions as the cause of climate change. And here you see the red country, China, is thereby, and the yellow country, obliged to pay into the greener areas to offset for the losses of climate change. When you factor in climate flexibility as the range of temperatures around the globe as a future trade asset, you see again red and yellow should be redistributing into green. When you set positive market incentives and factor in CO2 emission changes over time, you can see that a country like the US would shift from being a grantor into a beneficiary country, so it should receive funding for having curbed harmful CO2 emission rates in the last few years. When you put in historically grown bank lending rates in here, I show that the red and the yellow country has better access to funds for a transition into renewable energy, and thereby has a higher obligation to redistribute some of the gains of a warming globe into greener areas. And lastly, the last index with what I want to leave it is when you also factor in the consumption adjusted CO2 emissions, then you see that China changes from being a grantor into being a beneficiary, because China is using a lot of CO2 emissions to produce goods that are then consumed somewhere else in the world. And when you factor that in, see Switzerland actually should be granting into the greener areas of the world. And with this, I want to leave it with the futures and new book on the ethics of inclusion. I want to make the case that future is macroeconomic law and economics, make the case that disparate impact analysis in the future of behavioral economics, law and economics will be the future. And this book will be dedicated to future generations and students who are the future, about whom we should care today and craft models only in a discussion with those beneficiaries in future generations. And with this, I very much look forward to discussing these thoughts with the students.